1, 3, initiating broadcast of fascinating nouns in 3, 2, 1.
Hello everyone, and welcome to Fascinating Nouns. Now, if you are listening to this transmission, we are still the galaxy's most trusted source for incredible people, places, things, and ideas. Now together we arrive at this curious nexus point, and we will explore the strange, unusual, offbeat, bizarre, intriguing, interesting, invigorating, quirky, quaint, quizzical, weird, wild, wacky, the fun, the frivolous, and the fringe, plus all the spaces in between. I am your host, Daniel J. Glenn. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the show. Now, anyone who listens to this show, or frankly, any of the shows that I do, you'll probably pick up that I love animals. And not only regular run-of-the-mill animals, your pets, your wildlife, your zoo animals, but also your weird animals. The strange animals you've never heard of or that can do amazing things, or in some cases, can do very similar things to us humans. That is where today's guest comes in. I'm talking with Dr. Dani Rabaiotti, who wrote a series of books with her co-author Nick Caruso. Now, she's a zoologist at the Institute of Zoology in the UK, and she's written some pretty fun books that really kind of, they appeal to, not only they appeal to the 12-year-old in all of us, but they appeal to that general curiosity we all have, and the first book kind of encapsulates it all. It is called Does It Fart? And of course, we all have that question on our mind when we look at any animal. Does it fart? Is it farting currently? And has it just farted when we smell something pretty awful? Her second book, True or Poo. And the third book, the one that just came out last year, Believe It Or Snot. And this kind of looks into all of the mucusy, slimy kinds of animals. And that's what we're going to talk about today. I'm really excited about this. The 12-year-old inside of me is very excited about this. So let's jump right in with Dr. Dani Rabaiotti. Thank you so much for being on the show today. Now, your main area of expertise on the, let's say, legitimate side of your science business is studying climate change and its impact on wild African dogs?
So my study species is African wild dogs. They're also known as painted wolves, African hunting dogs. They have a lot of names. So the scientific name for them is Lycaon pictus, mm-hmm. which kind of literally translates to painted wolf. I look at how temperature impacts them and how climate change will impact them into the future using a load of data from our study site, our ZSL study site, among others.
Now, I looked up some of the stuff that you've done and some of your specialties. Let me see. I don't know if this is a comprehensive list, but you're modeling behavioral and population shifts resulting from increasing temperatures, ecdynastic species distribution models, climate change impacts on the African mammal conservation. But you're also looking at poop, smelly cousin the fart, and slimes. How do you kind of separate legitimate science? You've kind of made a name for yourself as kind of the scatological scientist. How do you kind of separate those two?
Yeah, I mean, I get this question a lot. I remember when we did the first book, Does It Fart? And the head of my department at the time came up to me and just like, Dani, you know, do you really want to be known for farts?
I mean, that should have been met with a resounding yes.
But the amount of people that I reach through that side of things is much bigger than I ever reach through my scientific papers.
Sure.
I'm not going to have like tens and thousands of people reading my scientific papers. Although I would encourage people to. A few of them are open access. So I think they're interesting.
You might have tens of people.
Yeah, I know. Exactly. If you're lucky, hundreds, maybe a few thousand. But yeah, so I think it just kind of works both ways. People don't necessarily want to read the kind of content that we put in the scientific paper. A lot of it is quite technical, relies quite a lot on kind of statistics and maths. So it's not really the same thing. And I think it all feeds into each other. Like, the books helped me to communicate my science, and my science helped me to research and write the books. So that's how I kind of meld those two.
No, but now, honestly, like, why even do the other science? You know, I assume you probably have a passion for conservation, but like, why not just to, I work in entertainment. I know that what it's like to embrace those types of things. I mean, why not just become the fart scientist or the scat scientist and just put out books like that and make $1 million becoming like the cool scientist who does that? I mean, there's lots of people out there who do similar things, and it doesn't necessarily delegitimize you, you know?
I think probably if I'd made $1 million, I might have switched completely. But I think it's just a case of I really enjoy doing both things. And although I've really enjoyed writing about farts and writing about poo and writing a stout snot, and I really enjoy doing the work related to that, it's quite hard, especially in this day and age, for authors to earn a lot of money off their books. Mm-hmm. So I think it's really tricky. A lot of people said, are you going to go like full time into science communication now? But it's a tough market out there.
No, that's very true. Now, how did this particular book series, and you know, we're talking about Does It Fart, True or Poo, and Believe It or Snot. And I imagine, you know, I don't want to give away any spoilers here, but I imagine your toilet trilogy is probably either going to finish that up. You're going to have Should It Shart or perhaps It Pees, I imagine, to kind of put a button on that. But how did this whole thing kind of come about, this whole book series?
So I think back in, must have been 2016, I want to say, in the January of that year, mm-hmm. I was on holiday with my family. And my brother said to me, oh, look, Danny, like, do snakes fart? And I was like,
"That's a good question.
I don't really know. I don't really know. I'm not a snake expert. But I was quite active on Twitter. A lot of scientists use Twitter to talk to people about their work and also to talk to each other about their work. So I did know someone who was a snake expert through Twitter. So I pinged him a tweet. I was like, David, do snakes fart? And he was very unimpressed by this question, but he did answer it. And he was like, sigh, yes. And other people saw this interaction and were like, oh, this is hilarious. And that's where Nick, my co-author, came in. We didn't really super know each other well at the time. Yeah, he suggested that we create a hashtag, Does It Fart? And we all share our study animals and whether they farted or not. And being a scientist, obviously, I was like, well, we've got to turn this into a spreadsheet. Because then when people ask, does it fart? Because as a zoologist, kids love these kind of questions. They ask us it all the time. Mm-hmm. So we thought the spreadsheet would be super handy for other zoologists. If they get asked any of these questions, they can refer to it, right? So that was kind of that. We thought that was just like a bit of a joke / potentially useful resource that we created.
Now, hold on. I want to pause you there. Two questions come up. Number one, I don't want to kill comedy. I try not to do that. But if I understand farting correctly, basically any animal with an intestinal tract that has microbes in it is probably farting, right?
Yeah, I mean, it does depend on the physiology of the animal. We found a couple of animals that did have both of those but didn't really fart.
That's interesting. Okay.
Yeah, so it did go a bit beyond that, but yeah, like quite a lot of animals that don't fart essentially don't fart because they don't even really have a digestive system.
Right,
so
right.
It's quite difficult. Or don't have a butt, you know, like.
Right. A place to expel it. Now, and also, from what I understand, this database, this is the largest crowdsourced database on animal farts in a human existence, correct?
Yeah, 100%, 100%. And that's kind of what happened with that, was that a few journalists that had followed this on Twitter then wrote stories about it, like scientists are crowdsourcing a database of animal farts. So they were really excited about it. We were kind of in the Washington Post, on Gizmodo, a bunch of other websites. And yeah, that was in the midst of all that, I ended up on Canadian TV. They projected me in front of the Houses of Parliament to talk about animal farts, which was hilarious.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, so that was when our publishers wrote to us and were like, do you want to turn this into a book? And it also actually, we got approached by a TV company and they adapted that into a kids TV show in Canada, well, web series as it is at the moment.
And so now you have like a 3-book deal or a 4-book deal? Because you have 3 of them out.
Yeah, so I think it'll probably stay as a trilogy, but there may well be other books from us in the future, maybe taking a slightly different tack. But yeah, I think there's a few people out there a bit disappointed that we never did Does It Vomit? That's one. Or Does It Puke? You know, we get asked about that a lot.
I don't like that one. That I mean, I imagine everyone in the world loves that. I've got a vomit phobia, so I would never read that book.
But that
kind of falls in line with everything that you're doing. Now, the latest one, this is a pretty... No, I should also mention, before we go on, you did all this stuff with Does It Fart while working on your PhD, right?
Yeah, so when we did Does It Fart, both me and Nick were PhD students.
Oh, wow.
And then for Trilby, the second book, I was a PhD student and Nick had just started his postdoc. And then the yeah. final one was just as I was finishing up my PhD. So that was intense.
Wow.
That was within a month, I handed in my PhD and we finished the first draft of Believe It or Snot. So.
Wow. So these books have kind of like gone with you on your whole doctoral journey.
Yeah, they definitely have. You know, a PhD here is about 4 years and did three books throughout the process as well. So,
wow.
But I think it worked quite well. It was a nice way to spend the downtime and yeah, it just slotted in nicely. I love reading and writing about animals. So it was nice to go beyond the really specific PhD research question and get a chance to write about something else.
I often hear that people who are working on their PhD are wondering what to do with their downtime. Now I should also mention, and only nerdy scientists would say something, would give you this level of criticism, but that, in an interview, I heard you say that a lot of people thought that the Does It Fart was pretty mammal-heavy. And so you decided to go with a lot of invertebrates for Believe It or Snot. Is this a real thing? I mean, did people really have kind of like animal envy?
Yeah, I mean, because these books were so much like part of the science community on Twitter, I think there was a lot of invertebrate people that were like, oh, this isn't very balanced with Does It Fart. But then it was harder with the invertebrates because a lot of them didn't really have much of a digestive system, so there wasn't really a lot to say, like,
right,
you know. So we definitely tried to make up for that a little bit in Believe It or Snot. We wanted more of those kind of weird and wacky animals that people might not have necessarily heard of included.
Yeah, you know, when I hear that stuff, it just so annoys me. It just feels like such a generational thing that, like, oh, you have to include every animal in every book. And it's like, does every animal have to be represented? I mean, isn't farts really a more evolved thing? Aren't the higher animals that do that? I mean, does an amoeba fart? Like, do we have to, are the protists and the microbiologists upset that they didn't get included? You know, I don't know. Well, I guess they're the ones who actually make the gas, right? Like the microbes do. That's just such a silly thing. I can't believe people gave you that criticism.
Well, I think it was all good-natured, like kind of a good-natured ribbing.
It
wasn't something that we had to do. It was a bit more like, I just want to see a bit about my animal.
Sure.
So it was kind of a chance for them to contribute as well.
Yeah. Well, and so how did you come up? Believe It or Snot is basically, in a nutshell, it's naturally occurring slime, I guess, be it mucus or lubricants or whatever can kind of be. You give a great definition for flatulence, but with this Believe It or Snot, what was really your definition of slime for an animal to be included in the book?
So we kind of had it, well, generally it was kind of a viscous liquid,
okay.
You know, something between a liquid and a solid,
sure.
Doesn't dissolve in water, sticky, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But it does go a bit beyond mucus. Most of it's mucus, but there's definitely a lot of other stuff. Like, for example, spit, that has mucus in it, but it's not just mucus.
Especially if it's a loogie.
And then other animals produce all sorts of weird slimes that we wouldn't really recognize because we don't have them in our own bodies.
Right. Right. Well, and you have a slime table. It's like 0 to 5. And
yeah,
it's funny how you even have some that have like half a star, basically, or half a slime spot.
Yeah.
So you go the whole gamut. There's like, I think there's a couple 4.5s and a 5 slime animal. One of the things I found interesting off the top is that you say how mucus does not dissolve in water. There's lots of really a lot of this stuff would almost make me vomit, so you can include me in your vomit book. But you guys do it in actually such a great way where it's very scientific and it doesn't really quite trigger that gag reflex. But just the idea that mucus doesn't dissolve in water, you know, it like that's so gross. But that's kind of what makes slime slime, right?
Yeah, 100%. Like, the reason mucus works like it does is because it doesn't dissolve in water, and that's why it's so important. Because if it did dissolve in water, every time we had a drink, we'd like lose all that lubrication that we have
right.
inside our bodies. So it would be a bit useless.
Right. Now, I didn't know that it was made out of proteins. That was kind of new to me. And I think they're called mucins. Is that? I mean, I guess that's
yeah.
why it's called mucus, right? And these are secreted
exactly.
by cells in the nasal cavity. This is what's interesting is they contain antibodies and bacteria-fighting proteins, which I guess makes sense. But you also talk about how when people are sick, their noses kind of fill up and how that's a bad thing. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, so basically our noses are one of the first defensives we have against infection. So the snot's all up in there, the hairs are up in there, and they catch bacteria, viruses, etc. And then the mucus kind of traps it and gets rid of it. And there's, you know, we've got cells in there that fight these infections. But once we've got a cold, what the cold virus does is it makes us extra, extra snotty. And also the inside of our nose lining can kind of swell up. We get a bit of a blocked nose. And that's bad because then we start like blowing our nose loads and we're like putting loads of pressure on our nose. Mm-hmm. And that can cause, you know, often you might see that your nose is bleeding a little bit, or it's getting rubbed. And that's a way that the virus can get into our bodies easier. So you... snot is good, but you don't want too much snot because then your nose gets irritated and then that breaks down the barriers to these viruses.
Right. It's equilibrium. You need to have just the right amount of snot in your nose for everything to work
exactly.
out properly.
Preferably clear as well. When it's green, that means you've got an infection, so that's not much fun.
Oh, God. Okay. That's good to know. I mean, everyone out there, that's really good to know. Now, in the book, it's basically structured by you have an animal and then you talk about its basically its snot capabilities or slime capabilities. There's a lot of good stuff.
Yep.
I want to talk about some of my favorite animals. And I did these in order, but I'm kind of jump through these because there's some pretty amazing stuff in here that I'd never heard of before. And I'm a pretty big animal guy. And so I try to look for very strange animals that do kind of cool things. And you taught me a lot of stuff. This book is really educational in all the right ways. Hedgehogs are very popular. They're in the zeitgeist. You know, Sonic the Hedgehog just came out. I didn't know two things. Number one, that they're immune to poisons. And number two, that they eat stuff, gross things, and turn it into a froth and then rub it on their bodies. How does this work?
So hedgehogs, that's people for a long time kind of wondered, especially when they first became popular as pets, they were like, why is my hedgehog essentially dribbling all over itself?
Yeah.
It's pretty gross to watch. So what they'll do is if something smells particularly strong, they'll chew it up. It makes like a gross smelling foam in their mouth, and then they just rub it all over their spines, basically covering themselves in foamy, smelly spit. And they'll do it for anything that's strong smelling. Could be what we perceive as a nice smell, like perfume. Could be what we perceive as a gross smell, like some dead animals. Basically, scientists think that there's two potential reasons for this. One of them might be that they're covering up their own smell. So that would make sense because anything strong smelling is going to make them smell like something else.
So it's like an insecurity is what you're saying. They don't like the way they smell and they want to smell like something else.
It's more like if I was a fox or a badger
yeah.
and I wanted to eat a hedgehog, then I would smell it, right? I'd be like, oh, where can I find it? And then you'd sniff it out. But if that hedgehog smells like, I don't know, like a dead animal or some perfume, it's not going to be like, oh, hedgehog.
Right.
Great dinner. It's going to be like, what is this?
That makes a lot more sense, actually, than emotional yeah. insecurity. And just so we're clear, they're not blue at all, are they?
Hedgehogs, no. They're brown. They're all brown. As far as I know, all of them are brown. someone's probably going to come up with this weird, obscure species of hedgehog where they're like, this one is not brown.
Right.
But yeah, no, they're generally brown. In the UK, we have hedgehogs are a native species here, so those ones are definitely brown.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay. I mean, it's a really adorable animal for sure. I mean, I guess if you're immune to poison, I guess you can kind of put anything in your mouth, but it's still funny that's not evolutionarily taken out that they would have like a list of things that they would chew up and spread on their body, not like kind of anything, whatever kind of held their fancy, you know?
Yeah, well, it seems to be like anything, which the other theory is that they're chewing up like toxic substances like toad skin to make themselves poisonous.
That's great.
So that their spines hurt more. And some poor guy found this out because they gave the hedgehog some toad skin and then the hedgehog chewed it up and then stabbed him.
Oh,
and he had a bad reaction. So,
That's so crazy. One of my other favorites is a parchment worm. And this one, I love this because they're not only slimy, they have glow-in-the-dark slime. It's bioluminescent. And they actually can shoot their glow-in-the-dark slime at a predator, and then the predator is now glowing in the dark, so their predator is now exposed to the next level up, the predator's predator, kind of like a bully's bully, you know? This is such a great defense mechanism. I would never go after a parchment worm if I was in the wild.
Yeah, they are absolutely incredible. There's all different species of these, but yeah, some deep-sea ones have this bioluminescent goo that they shoot at their predators if they get disturbed. But the most amazing thing, actually, I didn't know this before we did the research for the book. I was introduced to this by a friend who actually studies these animals. And they've evolved this glow-in-the-dark mucus that they chuck onto anything that might get in the way. But also, they don't actually have any eyes or any way to sense light, so they can't see that it's glow-in-the-dark.
Oh, wow.
They've just evolved that because it worked rather than they could actually see it, which I think is especially amazing.
Yeah, that's crazy. I mean, and it's such a great defense mechanism. I mean, I love that. You know, it's funny the stuff that goes on like down in the bottom of the ocean where there isn't any light. Like all the there's so many cool adaptations down there that it's kind of crazy how some of these things come to be, especially because their visual sense is essentially completely gone for most of the animals, you know.
Yeah, well, it's kind of like we do similar things as people. So, you know, some people have those lights on their house, and then if a burglar comes along, the light will shine on them when it senses them moving.
Yeah.
This is basically the parchment worm equivalent of that, where it like lights the predator up and then everyone can see it.
Yeah, that's a great analogy. That's very true. Just one of my favorite adaptations. In this one, you know, I'm a baseball fan. I haven't heard of a spitball in a long time, but apparently the slippery elm is a type of tree that's slimy, and baseball players used to use this for their spitballs back in the day?
Yeah, they did. They did. They chew it up. It's got some chemicals in it that make things extra slippery, basically, and foamy, and help it to foam up. So, yeah, it's the baseball players used to use it for their spitballs.
Wow. And it's obviously this is no longer legal, but so it must work way better than regular spit. But how did you know? Do you have any idea how people found this out or discovered this thing?
I think basically the chemicals in slippery elm, they have a property in them which will relieve. So, for example, if you have irritated mucous membranes, that's like the inside of your mouth or nose, or if you've got a cough, then chewing it would help with that. So I would assume that probably people knew that it had these medicinal properties, and then some baseball player was like, oh, that seems useful.
Right.
You know, I'll make my spit more slimy because I've noticed that this happens if I use it for something else.
Huh.
And then
that's pretty amazing. Yeah, I mean, it's kind of funny all the things that people used to. Baseball is a very funny sport when you look at the evolution of it. So spitballs, knuckleball, all the ways you can throw a baseball have always just been very fascinating to me. One of the other cool animals is a violet snail. I love this because the snail almost, it's very industrious because it essentially uses mucus to trap air bubbles to make a little raft that it basically floats upside down on. But if I understand this correctly, if that raft were to pop or anything, the snail basically sinks to the bottom and dies.
Yeah, exactly. So they rely on these rafts to move around. The rafts blow around the ocean and they just sit on the bottom of them, kind of like a sloth would be upside down. The snail instead hanging onto bubbles and it's upside down. But yeah, if the bubbles get popped, then the snail just sinks to the bottom and dies, which is terrifying.
Yeah,
like, can you imagine just floating around upside down on the water and then just, I'm really super glad I'm not a violet snail.
That is like my worst nightmare because besides a vomit phobia, I also have a shark phobia. And I read this article in a Reader's Digest when I was a kid, and it's traumatized me ever since. But the idea of slowly sinking down into the depths of the ocean is like terrifying to me. Even like when I see movies and they have the image of some, you know, like a big monster coming up from the bottom of the depths, and there's like this little person at the top of the water. You know, that stuff terrifies me.
Well, if you were the size of a snail, it would be even worse. Like
right?
Even like a little fish is gonna could eat you. So you wouldn't even have to worry about sharks. You know.
No, that's very true. Now the other thing about this, and this is true of a lot of animals, and this is one of those things that makes me wonder how in the world some of these animals have not gone extinct, but essentially they ride around solo on these rafts, so they can't really find a mate that easily. There isn't like a meetup group or anything.
Yeah.
So essentially, like, the males just kind of shoot their sperm into the water in the hopes, fingers crossed, that it finds a female at some point.
Yeah, so they just kind of chuck it everywhere. There's a lot of animals that reproduce in these ways.
Right.
And then hopefully a female will float through it. That's the thinking behind it. And animals like this produce loads, like absolutely millions of eggs and sperm,
right?
Because they basically got to fill the water with it in order to be able to reproduce.
Right. No, I mean, and that's the crazy thing is it's there's so much luck involved, you know? I mean, even I don't know, the numbers are astronomical to me. I don't know what they actually are, but that is just one of those things that just blows my mind that these animals can exist, you know?
Well, yeah, often they're animals that just have no control over their movement, or animals that are like stationary. For example, coral. If you go to coral, go up to a reef, like a coral reef during spawning season, right. Like the water is literally like milky because there's just so much eggs and sperm being released. Yeah.
Oh, wow. That is disgusting.
It is.
That's pretty gross. You know, and one of the other things, so speaking of animals that I'm amazed aren't extinct, this is one, I did this on one of my other shows. We talk about pop culture science, and this is the orange roughy, you call them slime heads in the book, but they're basically all the roughies. They have, what I think is interesting, we'll get about the mucus part in a second, but what's amazing about these animals is it's a fish that can live like 149 years or so. That's very specific. I'm going to say 150. I'm going to round it up. And they take about 30 years to reproduce. I mean, that's like basically the age of human beings in LA take about that long to reproduce, right? Like, that's crazy for a fish.
Yeah.
How in the world have they not gone extinct?
Well, I think basically they were pretty undisturbed. Animals that have these long reproductive cycles, they generally have really low mortality rates. So nothing's really eating them, and they're not really affected too much by disease. They don't get that much nutrients, so they're often quite slow growing, slow to mature. And these kind of animals are quite common in the deep sea because everything just moves a bit more slowly. And there's not as much food down there. So that's kind of how they keep going, is because although they take ages to breed, they don't die very often. So they have plenty of time to get around to it.
Yeah, I mean, I guess so. It's one of those amazing things. You don't think of fish having these extra long lives. You know, sea turtles, you know, we're used to that, whales and stuff. But 150 years is a long time. I mean, alligators live pretty long, too. They're like dinosaurs almost.
Although I do think that people would be surprised with how long goldfish even can live. You know, like people think that goldfish, they live like 1 or 2 years. But goldfish can live like 10 years plus.
Oh, I didn't know that. I know they're very hardy for sure, but I didn't know that. And so the roughy, they have basically their head is filled with mucus, right?
Yeah, so they have these like slime channels. And mostly around their head, which is how they get their other name, slime head.
Right.
I'm not really sure why people decided this was appetizing, but people did. And that's part of their lateral line system. So all fish have this. It's just slime heads they're kind of bigger and full of more slime.
Perfect for your book.
Yeah, exactly. And that helps them to sense like water pressure, movement in the water. So like if another fish is swimming nearby, it'll disturb the water currents, and then the slime heads will be able to sense it. I think probably the reason that they're more defined than in other fish is, again, they live quite deep, so there's probably not too much light down there, so they rely on them a bit more than other fish.
Right. So one of the things that I thought in the book, and I felt kind of silly for not making this connection, but you did it so beautifully, is obviously we've got dogs. They slobber a lot. They're as far as slimy animals go, some are pretty slobbery. But they had a major contribution to the psychological field that we still deal with today. Tell me what that is.
Yeah, so a really famous psychological experiment that's, you know, I mean, I did psychology at school and I studied this at school, was Pavlov's dogs. They're pretty well known, well known for having a lot of dogs. And the reason for that is very slime relevant. Pavlov was a psychologist, and he wanted to examine reflexes, and the animal he chose to do this in was dogs. They were pretty easy to access, so he noticed basically that when dogs hear someone walking up to them with food, then dogs dribble quite a lot, and he wanted to know if he could teach them to dribble when they heard a different sound other than the person who was feeding them approaching. So what he decided to do was to use a click. The story is often told with a bell, but apparently it was more of a clicker. And so every time they got fed, he would make the clicking sound. And then eventually there didn't even need to be any food. And whenever he click the clicker, then the dogs would start dribbling.
I wonder how the clicker turned into a bell. That's a pretty significant part of the story.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure either. But when I looked back over, like, because you can still access the original notes from that experiment, and yeah, there was no bell. I guess it's just people, it's easier to explain to people. And it would work with a bell. Like, you could definitely train your dog today to do it to a bell. So it may be that people who repeated it did it with a bell.
You could do it with a fart, too. I mean, you could do it with basically anything that came before food, right?
Oh, yeah. You know, dogs are amazing at learning, like, all sorts of different commands, and also, and their reflexes will basically happen with anything.
Right.
But you could do a sound, or you could do a movement. If every time you gave them food, you danced Gangnam Style, right, then they'd probably start dribbling when you did that. So right.
They're pretty amazing. I've got a dog that, she is very, very food motivated. And I actually am teaching her simple addition with food. Not quite algebra, but she's very capable. She's a very intelligent dog. And, man, it is amazing the things you can teach a pretty smart dog who's food motivated. Two very positive qualities in a dog. Now, we're about to hit on our first level 5 Slimer, and that's the hagfish. A fish that I've never heard of before, but this is a cool animal, and I love their defense mechanism.
So, hagfish are basically they're what we came up with as the slimiest animal. And yeah, a lot of people aren't familiar with them. They're a rather primitive species of fish. They're very ancient. They evolved a super long time ago, before most fish that we have today. They don't have a proper jaw even. That's how old they are. And like other fish, they're fairly slimy. Most fish are slimy. They're covered in mucus, after all, so that's generally a slimy sign.
Right.
But the hagfish, beyond that, they can produce a ridiculous amount of slime when they feel threatened. So they have these lines down their side, and they have special glands, and they release a slime which will expand over 10,000 times in water. Yeah, so like 40
wow.
milligrams turns liters of slime. Yeah,
that's incredible. And I love this because essentially what it does is any would-be predator, it blocks their gills and basically suffocates them.
Yeah, you can see some amazing videos of this online, actually, where a shark comes up and grabs a hagfish, and then suddenly it's just like, blam, slime. Its whole mouth and its gills, everything's just full of slime, and they're just desperately trying to get the slime out of their heads.
It's pretty amazing. Now, before we go any further, is it fishiest to say that all fish are covered in slime?
No, all fish are covered in slime. They would die if they weren't. They need that slime. Okay. Keeps their skin protected from the water.
Now, would they be offended if you said that? Would you have to be a fish to say that all fish are covered in slime?
I don't think the fish would be very offended. I think probably they wouldn't understand
right.
you.
In this day and age, I don't know, people, everything gets offended. So I'm imagining I'm going to be a little sensitive with the fish and say most fish are covered in slime, even though we all know that they all are.
Well, I think they would be proud to be covered in slime.
Do you think so?
Yeah, like, they've got to let their slime flag fly.
Right.
I don't think they'd have any shame about it.
Okay. All right, and you've worked with a lot of animals. If anyone's going to know that, it's going to be you.
Yeah.
So maybe it is. Maybe they are proud of it. I would be, for sure. I got to tell you, one thing I wouldn't be proud of is if I took stuff from my butt and mixed it with other things and then wiped it on trees. But that's kind of exactly what hyenas do. And they have a thing called hyena butter, which is, you know, from the
yeah.
from the butt butter family. This is really gross, but totally fascinating.
Yeah, so hyena butter is kind of like it's about the consistency of kind of slightly hard butter, maybe peanut butter, I guess. And it's kind of like really, really smelly, a really smelly paste.
Uh-huh.
And they produce this from a gland near their butt.
Mm-hmm.
And they rub it all over everything to be like, this is my territory, and to communicate with each other. It can tell other hyenas whether they're ready to mate and tell them to keep away, and all sorts of things. So yeah, that's how they scent mark. But it really is like a really gross substance. Like, a lot of animals will urinate or, you know, have these scent glands, but hyenas, you know, the fact is called hyena butter as well, I think, makes it particularly disgusting.
It does. And the fact that you compared it to peanut butter, it's something I love to eat all the time, and I'll never look at it the same way again. That's very visual. And this is one of the cool things about this is not only do they use this to mark territory, but other hyenas use their butt butter to kind of show allegiance to their group, essentially, right?
Yeah, so they'll all, in quite a lot of social animals, you'll see this happening. So they kind of overmark each other. So that will show that there's a whole clan of hyenas in that area, and that's their territory. And it can also give other hyenas an indication of how many hyenas are in that clan and that sort of thing.
It's pretty amazing, but I mean, it's really disgusting. And I imagine it also, are there any animals that like rub it off? Or do people pretty much stay away from any area that's taken over by a hyena?
Yeah, I think generally it wouldn't get rubbed off. There's definitely animals that probably ignore it. Like maybe lions generally are the ones in Africa that don't really care too much about what other animals are around. So maybe they wouldn't really care if they came across some hyena butter.
That's kind of their defining characteristic, I think, of lions, is they don't really care a lot.
Oh, yeah, no, 100%. As someone whose work is kind of based on fieldwork out in Africa,
yeah.
We always, everyone that doesn't study lions always like lions. They're such jerks.
They really are. I mean, yeah. But look, if they got a lot of swag. I remember I watched this. There's this famous video. It's called like the Battle of, I can't think of the name, but I'll put a link on the website. But it's this famous video that a bunch of tourists shot in Africa. And it's basically, I don't know, it's like it looks like a giant bull. They got these big horns. There's a baby version of that bull. That gets
probably a buffalo.
Yeah, probably. I don't know. It doesn't look like a buffalo, but let's just say it is. So three lions kind of are trying to basically eat this baby buffalo, and within seconds, this whole herd of buffalo come up, and there's, you know, probably 50 of them with these big horns, and they're going to take on these three lions. And what's amazing is it's three lions against probably 40 buffalo, and the three lions are like, is that all you got? Like, you, yeah, there's three of us, 50 of you. I think we're probably all right. It's this amazing video, and an alligator gets involved. It's one of the most amazing animal videos I've ever seen. And in the end, the spoiler alert, everyone's fine, you know, but it's a pretty
good
video.
Well, the lions are fine if they didn't get their dinner, are they? Probably hungry and sad.
I knew you were going to say that. That's true.
I study carnivores. I'm always on team carnivores.
You know, and the truth is, I understand. I get it. You know, most people are going to be rooting for the baby the baby bull, but I do understand that, you know, there's this great like poem that says, you know, when it's dawn, the gazelle has to run faster than the lion or it doesn't live, and the lion has to run faster than the gazelle or it doesn't live. And it's, you know,
yeah, exactly.
So it's all, yep, cycle of life. I get it, but that has nothing to do with slime. But there is an animal that I had never heard of this animal before. It's called I don't know if I'm going to say this correctly.
Larvation.
Is that it? Larvation.
Yeah.
This is crazy. This almost is like a spider of the sea. It basically takes mucus and builds like a little house out of it, right?
Yeah. There's quite a few filter feeding animals in our oceans, but larvations are probably the ones that build the most intricate filter feeding apparatus, and also they build it around their whole entire bodies, and then they just kind of float around, although they do have a little tail where they can wiggle a bit in each direction. And they kind of swim around in this house made out of mucus, and it has all these intricate holes in it, and they pull water through this system, so it creates like suction through, and the water passes through it, and then any like plankton or little bits that are floating about in the water that they might want to eat, they get stuck on the slime, essentially. And then they kind of eat it, which I think that was probably like the one way of animals eating their food that I was like, I'm so glad that I don't have to do that. Because can you imagine if you just, in order to catch food, you made basically like a net out of your snot, and then you threw it on, I don't know, some lettuce, if that's what you wanted to eat. And then you dragged it in, and then you had to eat all the snot as well as the lettuce.
that would be something. Yeah, I agree with that. I would not want to do that. It's very similar. You know, when you say it like that, it doesn't sound particularly appetizing. I was thinking of it more of being very similar to a spider, because they kind of do that, but they don't eat their own spider web.
Yeah, I think that's the big difference, really, is in order for the larvation to get the stuff that's stuck on the mucus, they also have to kind of eat some of that mucus as well. So that's not super nice. But then only a bit of it, and then the rest of it kind of gets tossed aside, and then they build a new one.
Yeah, you mentioned it gets discarded to the bottom of the ocean, and I just kind of imagine this bottom of the sea littered with all these old, snotty, you know, food-filled nets of mucus, but it's probably not quite like that.
Yeah, but that's actually super important. So carbon cycling, which is basically when carbon's taken from living things and then goes down to the bottom of the ocean, and then gets eaten by stuff at the bottom of the ocean, and then it gets cycled back up again. So that's really important for taking carbon from the top part of the ocean down into the depths. So that's a really important thing for our oceans. So well done, Love Asians. You did a good job.
Right. Look, they got to eat their own snot, but when it comes to their place in the world, they're extraordinarily important, irreplaceable animals. You know,
yeah.
One of the things I didn't know, this is kind of an interesting argument, this next animal, and this is the slow loris. Am I pronouncing that correctly? Now, you say
yep.
It's the only venomous primate, and that there's actually arguments on whether it is actually
yeah.
venomous or not. So tell me how it works, and then we can talk about whether it is actually venomous.
Yeah, so basically slow lorises have glands under their armpits, and that produces, I guess it would be a poison, because you don't want to eat it. So that produces this toxin, and they lick it, and it gets collected on their teeth. And then when they bite you, they are venomous, because that poison gets kind of put by their bite into you. So that's why people say that they're venomous. But actually, it's kind of debated, because they're not really producing, they're not really injecting the venom. It's just a poison that they're putting into their mouths and then putting into you. So that's kind of where the contention comes from.
And that makes sense. But that feels, I don't know, me personally, their body produces the venom. If they were eating, like, let's say, fire ants or toxic ants, and then using their ant's venom and repurposing it and to attack their prey, I would say you have an argument. But if the animal itself, they're producing it in their, you know, in their armpits, so that's their venom-producing animal, and they're injecting it is tricky, but they are biting it. They are placing it inside of the body of the other animal through their teeth, which, while is not like snake-level injection, it's still like a rudimentary injection.
Yeah, and it's the age-old debate, right? Like, what people say is, like, if you lick it and you die, then it's poisonous. But if it bites you and then you die, then it's venomous.
Oh, I see. Poisonous versus venomous. So that's really the argument. I see.
But it probably wouldn't be great if you licked it either, so.
Right. Well, and yeah, I guess it's, yeah, they said it's really interesting. I'm going with venomous on this. I think this is really, it's probably, you know, the evolutionary step between venom and poison, but I'm going with venom on this one. Where do you stand?
Yeah, I think I probably also am more on the venomous side, because I feel like it's biting you and then that's making it irritate your skin. So it feels more like venomous to me.
There it is. I like that. We'll put up a, you know, I may put up a poll to see what other people think, but this is a really, I mean, just the fact that it's a primate's really interesting. I mean, there's very few venomous mammals. You know, I think the platypus is one of the only venomous mammals. So just the fact that in this small little category, it's just amazing that this even exists to any level is pretty cool to me. But, you know, I mentioned ants. This is a really cool one. The horned lizard basically uses
yep.
its mucus to eat ants that are toxic to the lizard, but it wraps them up in this mucus. I like this. This is really cool.
Yeah, no, it is really impressive. This is like one of a couple of species that we found used slime for these sorts of purposes. So they don't really want to eat the kind of dangerous ant species, but if food is scarce, they don't really have too much choice. They, as you said, they'll cover them in mucus and in their spit, basically. This means that the ants can't bite or sting them. It stops them, yeah, basically attacking them from the inside. And that's pretty cool. And there's a few other animals that do this. For example, nightjars also cover all of their food in loads of gross spit so that it helps them feed it to their chicks without them getting all scratched and gross moth bits everywhere.
Right. Mucus is it's a very helpful, I mean, it mitigates the amount of damage that something can do to you if you wrap it up in a bunch of slime. And a lot of animals kind of use that, the power of slime in that respect. And I like that a lot. We talked about the larvations kind of making a house out of it. There's a bird called the swiftlet that actually makes a nest out of saliva.
Yeah.
And this is pretty crazy. How does it make saliva that is strong enough to hold its eggs and itself?
Essentially, they just have special chemicals in their saliva. Especially in the breeding season, their saliva changes in consistency, ready for building these nests. And they just go backwards and forwards. They find a nice spot on a rock, and they go backwards and forwards, and they lick a line. And then by the time they've got to the end, that line is kind of dried, solidified, and then they go back again, and then they keep creating these lines until they've basically got a nest stuck onto the wall.
It's like 3D printing with spit.
Yeah, it literally is so similar to that. It is.
That's crazy. And you mentioned that they're in China, and the Chinese have been using their nests basically in soup for like 400 years.
Yeah, it's a really, really old recipe. People tend to harvest. There was worries that it was unsustainable, so some people in China actually started building special houses for the birds to make their nests in. And then before they laid the eggs, they would take the nest and they build a new one. Or more often, after the eggs had hatched, they would take the nest off the walls and turn it into soup. And it's very high in protein because it's full of this special protein-filled spit.
Right.
So, yeah, that's a very traditional recipe, still eaten today. It's quite a thick soup that it creates, but those nests are quite expensive.
Have you had it before?
No, I've never had it myself, but I think it's like fairly commonly eaten, and you can probably buy it in a lot of places. To be honest, you can buy the nests like online, but always make sure that they're ethically collected, because you don't want to be buying ones that are taken when the eggs are still in the nest.
Exactly. I mean, it's definitely, that's something. I don't know if I would have the gumption to eat it, but maybe I don't know. There's lots of, it's funny, you look around the world. I mean, there's also the century egg, which is also something else that I don't know that I would eat either, but it's funny when you look at these things that have been eaten for so long, is that it's, you know, it's such a part of the culture that it's kind of cool to see that kind of carried on, especially when it's done ethically, you know, like it's kind of a really cool cultural thing to see.
Yeah, and it's definitely good to see that people were worried that the numbers were getting low, so then they made extra places for the birds to breed in exchange for people to take the nests up afterwards. So,
no, that's great. You know, and we've gone for most of the interview without talking about snot rockets, but whales apparently have big snot rockets when they come up and they shoot out of their blowhole. You talk about how people are actually trying to capture these chunks of snot and study it. This is actually a big deal for scientists. Why is it such a big deal?
Yeah, so if you're a whale biologist, it is quite likely that you're going around collecting their snot. It's quite a common way to monitor them. It can tell you a lot about a whale. For example, what hormones they have, how stressed they are, if they have any diseases. So this is kind of pretty crucial information. It can tell you about the health of a population. But this means that people have to collect it. Whales live in the sea. They're kind of hard to find. And there's kind of two main ways of doing this. The old-fashioned way, which is you drive up on a boat to a whale and you wait for it to surface, and then you catch it with a petri dish on the end of a pole.
Okay. That's very primitive.
So that's the traditional method. Right. Or more recently, one group of researchers have been using drones, where they fly the drone with a petri dish on the bottom over the top of the whale as it blows out, and then that collects the data for them.
Wow. I mean, it's a lot of work to catch a blasted booger from a whale, but it's I guess if it's so important, it tells you so much information, you got to get it somehow, right?
Yeah, definitely. And it's nice to be able, you know, traditionally, most of the information we had from whales came from whales that washed up on the beach. So it's cool. Like, all the time we're learning new methods to study these animals without having to wait till they die.
Right. That's important. You know, a lot of these animals I looked up pictures of, and one of the most impressive was the cave glowworm. These are, you know, bioluminescent cave dwellers. They glow, and they can basically attract moths to them and insects and things like that. But they also, you know, much like the levations, they produce a mucus web. This is pretty cool. Have you seen these things in person?
I sadly have never been to New Zealand. So it's a long way from the UK. It's like literally the other side of the world. So I haven't, but I've heard that it's absolutely stunning if you go to these caves, because there's all these glowing worms on the ceiling, but you're quite far away, so they don't look like worms. That doesn't sound nice when you describe them as worms, but it's been compared to like stars in the night sky. It's pitch black, and all you see is the little pinpoints of light on the ceiling. So it's supposed to be amazing. I'd love to see them.
Yeah, the pictures are really cool. I mean, it looks stunning, to be perfectly honest with you. Now, I want to get to a couple other animals really quickly. My favorite animal is the octopus. What I love about this is the octopus basically uses its mucus combined with ink to create several different concoctions based on what it wants to do. This is amazing and does not surprise me given the intelligence of an octopus.
Yeah, so they can do some pretty incredible stuff by mixing in mucus with their ink. For example, they can create like a fake octopus almost. So they'll create this shape, but because it's got mucus in it, it hangs in the water much longer than if they just release their ink. And then if a predator is trying to eat them, it tries to eat the inky octopus instead and then gets a mouthful of nothing.
Right. That's pretty amazing. It's really cool, and I love this because they're such an intelligent animal that there's probably even other uses of an ink mucus concoction that we probably haven't witnessed, but they're whatever the viscosity they need, they kind of mix it up. I really like that. One of the other animals, a parrotfish, when I was studying marine biology for a little bit, I remember parrotfish were one of my favorite animals. These guys kind of produce a mucus sleeping bag, right?
Yeah. So parrotfish, if you're ever on a coral reef, when it comes to nighttime, you'll notice that quite a few species of parrotfish, they won't just hide in amongst the rocks, but they'll produce this snot sleeping bag. And it's produced by their gills, and it envelops their whole body. So they're just basically sleeping in a mucus sac, which people used to think that it helped them sense predators early, because the predator would swim into the bag and then the parrotfish would be alerted. But they actually think now that it protects them from parasites. And they found that parrotfish with the snot sleeping bags had less marine isopods. They feed on parrotfish blood. It's kind of gross. I'd be sleeping in a snot sleeping bag too, instead of having those on me.
As long as you don't have to eat it every morning.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. I'd maybe avoid that bit.
Right. Sure. All right. And the last one, we got to talk about the sea lions, because you mentioned that they've got the worst farts in the animal kingdom. We're going to talk about that in a second. But they're also incredibly snotty. These guys are on like the top five list for both of these books. How and why are they so snotty?
Well, this is the thing, is like, what, both of these entries came from talking to zookeepers, where they were like, oh my goodness, this animal always farts on me, or in this case, always sneezes on me. They sneeze all the time, and they try and get rid of a lot of animals that live in salt water sneeze out their salt, so I think that's probably part of it. But they also seem to like shake their head at the same time, which means if you're near them, all the snot, and they also have like mucus tears that stop their eyes from like getting affected by salt water, so those also go all over you. And yeah, they just don't really care. They sneeze all the time. So like, I've spent a lot of time around, well, fur seals, which are quite similar, and yeah, they're the same, just always sneezing everywhere, all over each other, all over anything near them. They just don't really care.
That's pretty amazing. We didn't even get to pygmy speed whales and their anal syrup, and banana slugs. You know, I love them as one of the best mascots in college sports. Slime molds, boxfish, upside down jellyfish. I mean, we've scratched the surface of your book. You've got so many amazing animals, and it is pretty incredible just how universally useful slime is, no matter what form it takes. I mean, that's what I just found really incredible about this book, is just how useful snot can really be.
Yeah, and I think the amazing thing about it is there's things that we, even in people, we use slime and snot for an amazing array of things. And when you expand that out into the animal kingdom, it's incredible how many different uses these animals have for slime and what they are doing with them.
Yeah, it's unbelievable. So how can people get in touch with you? How can people get a hold of the book? I know you mentioned you're active on Twitter.
Yeah, so I'm on Twitter at Dani Rabaiotti. My surname's a bit hard to spell, but, you know, just give it a try. I'm sure I'll pop up somewhere. But also, you can buy our books on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, if you ask at an independent bookstore, I'm sure they'd be happy to stock it. A lot do. So that's probably the best way to get them. And my Twitter handle and Nick's as well. And also our wonderful illustrator, Ethan. They're all in the books as well.
And I'll make sure I'll have links to this on the website so people can find you. Now, you're going to stick around. We're going to talk about farts. Everyone's been waiting to hear about farts. They're the funniest, probably the funniest sound in the animal kingdom. We're going to talk for 10 minutes on that. But, you know, I got to tell you, this is such an incredible book. Surprisingly entertaining and extraordinarily informative. I loved it. I did love learning about mucus. Believe it or snot, Dr. Dani Rabaiotti, thank you so much for being on the show today.
Thanks for having me.
And I want to thank everyone for listening. Have a good night.
End of transmission. Thank you.